The background to today's discussion is the period we're living in, which often we've said is the most turbulent period in history, really, in terms of not just economically the crisis that we're going through, but politically and socially, obviously, as well, with political earthquakes taking place on a frequent basis now, and these mass social movements in every country. But today's discussion is going to focus on the economic crisis and the question of capitalist crisis, because obviously we find ourselves in the seventh year of crisis, which began in 2007, 2008, and importantly, there's no end in sight. There's talk of recovery, of green shoots, but really I would say this is a bit of a sick joke, where you know, there's no real recovery for the 99%. We see stagnant wages, declining living standards, the rise of zero-hour contracts, precarious labour, and obviously continued austerity and continually growing inequality as well. So I think it's important to step back when we hear this kind of talk of recovery, to step back and see the bigger picture that we're in. And understand not only is the kind of growth they're talking about very weak, really it's the weakest recovery that capitalism's ever seen, very anemic recovery we would say, but more importantly it's just really a temporary blip on an otherwise downward trajectory. You know, you can always zoom in on a graph and you'll see a slight upturn. You zoom back out and you'll see that that's just a tiny flick upwards on an otherwise downward trajectory as far as the timeline of capitalism goes. Even a dying patient in a hospital will occasionally see a kind of spasm of life before the lights eventually go out. On a global scale, really there is no real recovery at all. You see in fact that all the major engines of the world economy have stalled. These were the words of Dr. Nouriel Roubini, a professor in America, who's actually earned the unfortunate nickname of Dr. Doom because he predicted the crisis before 2008. But he wrote last year how all the major engines of the world economy were stalling, saying how even in the US and the UK, where you had this weak growth, it was credit fueled, it was on the basis of a housing bubble. Obviously in Japan, we've seen 2 decades really of stagnation and weak growth and continued resurgence of recession. In Greece and Europe, you see a crisis that is ongoing, continually just kicking the can down the road. Again, no real end in sight to that one. The situation there has not been resolved at all, and the idea of Grexit is very much still on the cards, and that will really be the first falling domino in the inevitable breakup of the Eurozone. And there's more on that in this afternoon's discussion on Europe. But importantly now, what we see is also China, which for years has been one of the main engines keeping the world economy going over the last few years. Now we see that also slowing down, starting to stall there as well. And really what you see in China is the same sort of process that we've had in the US and Europe, but obviously with a delay. You've got rising debt levels, local government debt, credit bubbles, and a stock market that's just crashed. Basically all of this is a reflection of how China tried to get out of the last crisis, where basically it was very much an economy reliant on exports to the West, on obviously cheap labor, being exploited by multinational companies, and all these commodities that China was churning out going to the West, and obviously that collapsed with the recession of 2008-2009. China then went on an investment binge, really is the largest Keynesian program that was ever seen, of government stimulus into infrastructure, into housing construction, huge investment in major sections of the economy like steel and shipbuilding. And you see the result of this today. Obviously, the last couple of weeks in Britain, talk of all these steel mills, steel plants closing down because of the tsunami of cheap steel that's flooding the markets in Europe and Britain and America. Basically, subsidized steel that the Chinese government's been subsidizing for years in order to basically provide cheap raw materials, cheap commodities to the rest of the construction infrastructure sectors. And the result is that now they've built up this huge excess capacity, because the whole world the rest of the world is obviously stuck in this stagnant economic situation. China's slowing down. The demand for things like steel is falling. The demand for things like oil is falling. That's why you see the oil price also dropping in recent months. And the result is now you've suddenly got this huge what the bourgeois call excess capacity, what Marxists refer to as overproduction. This huge excess capacity, particularly in commodities like steel, being dumped on the markets in Europe and Britain, and basically forcing British industries, or in fact, in the case of Britain, it's actually Indian-owned companies like Tata being pushed out of business. But all of this is a reflection, all of this slowdown in China, the stock market crash where you had for years a massive stock bubble being formed, basically huge amounts of profits accumulating in China that couldn't find an outlet and were therefore just inflating this stock market. That's crashed. The Shanghai Stock Exchange crashed a couple of months ago now. And it's all of that is a massive warning sign. Even David Cameron a few months back said that there's red lights flashing on the dashboard of the world economy everywhere, and China is the latest one that's obviously scaring the ruling class, scaring the capitalists about the idea that there's going to be a new world slump, really, even deeper than the last. And because now with China slowing down, it's bringing all these other countries into the crisis as well. Countries like Brazil, which are now in recession, Australia, Indonesia, South Africa, a lot of these countries that were reliant on exporting raw materials to China. With the slowdown in China, you now see the slowdown in all of these countries. In other words, what you see is a real interconnectivity on a world scale. The whole world economy is interlinked, and each obviously you don't get crisis occurring simultaneously everywhere. It's a kind of combined and uneven development, if you like. But one after another, like mountain climbers, all attached by a rope. As one falls, the rest fall with it. And China is the latest one to go, bringing down the rest of the world economy. It's obviously going to rebound back on the West, and that's why you're seeing all these flashpoints occurring at the same time. It shows you the severity of the crisis on a world scale. But stepping back from the immediate kind of crisis, or the crisis of the last 7 years, I think it's also important to look at the kind of historical development of capitalism over the last few decades. And if we see that, if we take that even bigger view of history, we see that really capitalism is in a period of senile decay. It's very much become a system that can no longer develop the productive forces, where you have this enormous technological, scientific, kind of cultural and industrial potential, but none of it can be fulfilled under capitalism. You've got so many symptoms of this we see, such as automation. The idea that there is this an incredible level of automation or potential technological development in society today, but rather than it leading to increased leisure time or to better wages, we're seeing basically all the technology. As Marx pointed out in Capital, actually, he writes that all of the machinery, all of the technology, all of this investment actually doesn't lead to rising living standards at all. But what he said is it leads to the accumulation of misery and toil at one end and the accumulation of profits at the other. And that's what we see today, where even bourgeois commentators, a pair of MIT economists, wrote a book called Race Against the Machine, the idea that now mankind isn't benefiting from automation anymore. The technological progress we've seen is just leading to a polarization. It's leading to this greater inequality in society, where we're now, where labor is in a race against the machinery that, rather than liberating us, is enslaving us. We're seeing this contradiction of unemployment on the one hand, mass unemployment, alongside overwork on the other, a completely irrational contradiction. That the idea of poverty emits plenty, the fact that we have this huge piles of idle cash, actually, this contradiction of austerity alongside massive accumulation of wealth in the bank accounts of the world's biggest businesses, for example, in Britain, something like 750 billion accumulated in the bank accounts of British big business. In Europe, the figure is about 2 trillion euros. In America, $2 trillion, I think. And in fact, Apple alone sits on something like 150 or $200 billion worth of cash reserves that it's built up, but that it's unable to use because of this huge excess capacity, this huge overproduction on a world scale. And it's for this reason, because of this enormous barrier to investment, to the development of the productive forces, that you see, again, even the serious bourgeois commentators talking about things like secular stagnation. This is the term that was come up with by Larry Summers, the former US treasurer, who basically said that because of this huge debt mountain that we've accumulated, this huge excess capacity in the system that's been built up, we're looking at a situation where the economies of the world aren't going to be growing not just for decades, but secular stagnation, which means lasting a century. And Paul Krugman, the Keynesian Nobel Prize winning economist, called it a permanent slump, basically. The idea that you know, we're not just talking about years of austerity here, but decades of low growth, crisis, and as I say, the austerity to go with it. And the important point is in all of this, that the capitalists and the academic representatives, their political representatives, their apologists, none of these people really have a solution to this long-term slowdown and decay of the capitalist system. So the question we have to ask ourselves today is, well, how did we end up here? Because this is the question that's obviously never asked by the bourgeois economists. In fact, to ask the question genuinely, to try and answer it, would actually obviously reveal why we're still stuck in this crisis, and more importantly, would reveal the only way out of it. Because in 2008, you had a situation where, you know, the crisis hit, and all the so-called experts were left scratching their head. You know, they couldn't explain the real origins of the crisis. It was called a credit crunch, or you know, just merely a greedy bankers, or just a financial crisis. But we'll see later how this is all very superficial analysis. And going back to Paul Krugman, he said everything we've learned about economics in the last 30 years is at best wrong and at worst harmful. And he's, as I say, one of the so-called experts. And so it's obviously for this reason that you had a lot of people then turning not towards the kind of modern academic textbooks or papers, but actually to the writings of someone who died 130 years ago. A whole swathe of articles came out in the wake of the crisis saying Marx was right. Time magazine, I think, was writing one. Rolling Stone and the BBC produced a whole series called Masters of Money, where they looked at Marx as one of the leading economists in history. And all of these people were trying to therefore, you know, look back and say, well, what was it Marx said about capitalism that can help explain today? And obviously, from a bourgeois perspective, they always, you know, say, well, Marx was right about capitalism, but, you know, wrong about his conclusions. He had a good analysis of that, but couldn't explain a real alternative. But nevertheless, you know, there was obviously a rising interest. There still is a rising interest in what Marx had to say about capitalism and crisis. You saw sales of the Communist Manifesto and Das Kapital booming. I think there was even a manga version produced in Japan, apparently. But all of this shows, you know, the traditional mainstream economics has reached an impasse. It can't explain what's going on. And therefore, it's important for us to go back and say, well, what did Marx really say in Capital? What did he really say about how capitalism worked? And it's, I think, to start off with, when we look at Marxist economics and his analysis of capitalism, we have to understand that Marx wasn't reinventing the wheel in the sense of he wasn't just plucking ideas out of nowhere, sucking them from his thumb. He based himself actually on the economists who'd come before him, people like Adam Smith and David Ricardo, who were like the high point of classical political economy. And he basically wanted to say, look, even if we take everything you've said as true, you know, you've developed a scientific analysis of the economy, you're treating economics like a science, as it should be. We should treat all subjects in a scientific way, that's to say in a materialist way, trying to uncover the general laws and patterns and tendencies of the system. But he said, I'm going to take your premises and show by developing them, by pointing out the limits and the logical next step, actually show how the very premises that these people had built themselves on actually led to a much more revolutionary understanding of what was needed as an alternative. And importantly, when we're understanding Marxist economics, we have to understand Marx's whole method. You know, it's not like Marxism is split up into completely different subjects that each have their own kind of analytical framework. Marxist economics was merely built on Marxist philosophy, the idea of dialectical materialism. If we really want to understand how the economy works, we have to look at it in a dialectical way. That is to say, we have to see it as a non-linear system, as a dialectical system where it's all interconnected, as I said, where there's particulars and generals, where there's general tendencies and patterns. But at the same time, each individual crisis is unique, but there is generally laws of crises. Why capitalism goes into crisis, we can still understand. By analysing all the particulars, we can actually get a general sense of the laws and the tendencies within capitalism that interact to create this general pattern of crisis within the capitalist system. Importantly, Marx had he didn't see capitalism as a kind of ahistorical thing, but obviously something that had developed historically out of feudalism. And in fact, in its early stages, Marx said capitalism was a very progressive system. In its heyday, it played a very progressive role from a historical point of view, in the sense that he said it accomplished wonders far surpassing Egyptian pyramids and Roman aqueducts. He said it played a very revolutionary role, in fact, in the sense that it had swept aside all the old fetters of feudal relations. It had played a progressive role historically, and what he meant by progressive was not a moral question about how well it treated people. In fact, he said from a moral standpoint, capitalism was reprehensible. It had come, he said, come into existence with blood dripping from every pore. That was the words he writes in Capital. But he understood from a historical point of view, it played a progressive role. And what did he mean by that? He meant that it was able to develop science and technology and agriculture and industry and so forth to such a level that it created the potential for a new form of society, for a socialist society, a society of superabundance. It concentrated all the old scattered forces of production. Whereas before you had peasants working on their own little plots of land or on the land of the feudal lords, now you had the peasants ripped from the land by the, forcibly actually. Capitalism had come, as I say, into being with the help of the state, the forcible ripping of the peasants from the land to create this new class of people who didn't own their own means of production, who didn't have the land to work on to feed themselves, but were forced to basically go into the cities, go into the new emerging cities, into where the industry was developing, where the capitalists were, and where they had nothing to sell but their own labor power. Capitalism had concentrated the forces of production, created industry, created factories, and in fact started to create monopolies, not just in one country, but global monopolies, worldwide businesses, and a world market that was an incredibly prophetic analysis of Marx in the Communist Manifesto, where he talks about capitalism, being the driving force behind capitalism, chasing the capitalists across the world in search of new profits, in search of new markets, creating globalization. This was quite incredible to be writing about this at a time where really there was only a handful of genuinely capitalist countries in Britain and France and Germany, America, but yet he's describing a process that now we've only started talking about in the last 25 years, the idea of globalization, of an integrated world market. But as I say, what was What was this? What were the driving forces that Marx identified as being responsible for this motor force? What was the motor force of this progression? Well, he said it was profit, it was private ownership and competition. These are the basis of capitalism that drove it forward. It was ultimately capitalism, he said. This wage labor and capital relation. That's what Marx defined capitalism by. He said, if you read Capital, he starts, you know, there's lots of different places he could have started the book, but he starts with the question of the commodity. He says capitalism is a system where commodity production is now universal. You'd always had commodity production throughout class society in the sense of people not producing for themselves, but producing for the market, producing to exchange. But capitalism is the first time where this becomes generalized, where it becomes the dominant mode of production, where now the vast majority of the economy is based around production for a market. You've still got on the fringes, obviously, people, peasants working on their own land and small craftsmen and so forth producing for themselves, whatever. But the vast majority of production becomes production for a market. And in this respect, he said he tried to identify what was the basis of commodity production. He said a commodity, what was a commodity? Well, it was something that had, on the one hand, a use value. It had some sort of utility. It was useful to, you know, people. There was a demand for it in society. It had some sort of need for it. But he said at the same time as having a use value, commodity had to have an exchange value. In other words, there was some sort of quantitative relationship between one commodity and another. As soon as you bring your commodity to the market for exchange, and it then has an exchange value. As soon as you can exchange it, you've got to say, well, how much of one thing can you exchange for another? And the real question that Marx identified and tried to answer, the one that had baffled the economists who came before, like Adam Smith and David Ricardo, they understood the question of value. They understood, David Ricardo had a labor theory of value in the sense of understanding that value, this exchange value, what ultimately determined the amount of one commodity that could be exchanged for another, was the question of labor time. Commodities were exchanged in general, Marx said. And Ricardo said was on the question of labor time, of how much labor had gone into to this commodity, not just the living labor in the form of wages, but all the previous labor in the form that's crystallized in the tools and the raw materials that had gone into producing these commodities, and it was that exchange value represented the exchange in general. Ricardo had said it was just individual labor time, but Marx took it a step further and said no, it's about socially necessary labor time. It was, in other words, if you were less efficient and tried to bring a commodity to market that had taken you longer than the socially average time needed to do that, then obviously you'd find you couldn't just charge more because you'd be outcompeted by those who had more efficient production, who had better technological level and could produce in less time for lower cost, basically. So in other words, there was a what Marx called a socially necessary labor time that was constantly changing through investment and developments of technology and machinery and so forth. And it was this that formed the exchange value, that formed the basis of how much of one commodity could be exchanged for another. In general, Marx said. Obviously, the idea of the law of value within Marxist economics, again, it's like all laws within Marxism, it's not an iron law that kind of exists in a metaphysical realm, but rather is a general tendency where as long as you could infinitely reproduce such commodities, then the law of value would apply. Where you had some sort of scarcity or some sort of block or barrier to the development of that commodity, then obviously you would get mismatches between supply and demand, and prices could diverge from the actual value, monopoly prices, for example. But in general, you had this law of value that operated kind of behind the backs of people, if you like. You know, it's not a law you can grasp or something that you can identify. But it was operating behind the backs of the capitalists, and obviously asserted itself through the idea of competition and the invisible hand, as Adam Smith called it. But what was different in capitalism, Marx identified, was, you know, the question of now you had this generalized commodity production, generalized private ownership and competition and production for profit. And the question Marx tried to identify was where does profit actually come from? It's not just something that that you can just cheat your neighbor. You know, if you there's not just one set of people who are very good at basically buying cheap and selling dear. And he said if that was the case, you just kind of generally get inflation in the economy. The real basis for profits, Marx said, could not lie in exchange and on the market, but actually had to be identified in the source of production itself. And in this sense, he identified profit as ultimately coming from the unpaid labor of the working class. In the course of the day, workers would produce a certain amount of use values. And the 8-hour day, for example, would be that would be the value of the commodities produced in the course of a day would have 8 hours worth of labor time, for example. But it would take workers only, say, 4 hours to actually produce the equivalent value of their own wages, and the other 4 hours, therefore, were what Marx called surplus value. The fact that now in those 4 hours, Marx identified saying, well, that effectively the worker is working for free in that period of time, and it was that was a source of value, the unpaid labour of the working class. And what was unique about capitalism now is you have this system where the workers are selling their labor power. They're selling their ability to work. You've got this class of people who have nothing to sell but their ability to work. And you have the capitalists who are buying that labor power, buying that ability to work for a period of time, whether it's a day or an hour or a week or a month or whatever. And the point under capitalism is now you've got the what makes it so revolutionary was because now the capitalists are buying that time, and it's up to them to try and squeeze out of that time as much that out of that labor power, out of the worker, as much actual labor as they can. Try and squeeze as much use value out of that out of the period of time they've got, and that meant there was an incentive for the first time to really invest in increasing productivity and trying to produce more in the space of less time, and it was that. That was the real driving force, trying to, you know, push down the hours of the day that were needed to go to wages, increase the proportion of the time that was going towards the creation of surplus value. All of that was what gave capitalism a very dynamic nature to it, because it was driving the capitalists to constantly try and lower their costs of production, to invest in machinery and technology, increase productivity and decrease their costs, in the hope of obviously ultimately increasing their market share, driving others out of business, and thus gaining super profits. But Marx pointed out that all of that progressive side of capitalism, all of these forces that drove it forwards in terms of profit, private ownership, and competition, all of these at a certain point turned into their opposite and actually become a barrier to the development of capitalism. And that's because of a contradiction that Marx outlined at the heart of capitalism, where although each capitalist is acting very rationally in the sense that they're all trying to push down their own costs, you know, replace labor with machinery, increase productivity, all in the sake of increasing profits. That's all very rational from the point of view of the individual capitalist. But the point is that when all the capitalists now are doing this at the same time, you end up with a result that's very irrational for the system as a whole, because each capitalist, in driving down wages, in replacing workers with machinery, is basically cutting away at the market, the ability to buy for the society as a whole. It's driving, you know, driving down the wages is basically cutting away at the market for the very goods that capitalism as a whole is producing. So while it's very rational for one capitalist to drive down his costs you know, if they're hoping that all the other capitalists, meanwhile, are going to keep paying their workers nicely so they can buy all the goods up that capitalism is producing. But obviously, everyone's doing the same thing, and the result is this contradiction of overproduction, where suddenly you know the system finds itself in a situation where too much is being produced, where the productive forces are basically coming up against the limits of the market. And as I said, that is an inherent contradiction within capitalism because of the nature of where profits come from. The fact that profit is merely the unpaid labour of the working class means that you've always got this situation within capitalism where the wages, the market for the goods that capitalism is producing, are only a fraction of the wealth that's actually being created. And there's this huge surplus that cannot find an outlet. And that's why Marx called this overproduction. The idea that he said that you had, for the first time in history, famines, not because there was scarcity or not because there was too little, but because there was too much, he said. Too much commerce, too much industry, too much means of subsistence. These are the words of the Communist Manifesto. As I said earlier, the idea of poverty amidst plenty is contradiction of overproduction. Now, the real question we have to ask ourselves in this situation is, if there's this inherent contradiction within capitalism, why aren't we in a permanent crisis? Why isn't capitalism for the last 200 years been in a permanent state of crisis? How does it overcome this contradiction? And Marx I understood and identified that as well. In Capital Volume 2, for example, he talks about the idea of there being two different departments within the economy. The idea that capitalism produces, on the one hand, the goods, the consumer goods that go into reproducing the working class, consumer goods and so forth, Department 1. On the other hand, it also produces capital goods, the goods that are actually new machinery, new infrastructure, new means of production. And it was this interplay between the two departments where capitalists constantly took that surplus and reinvested it back into new machinery, new into technology. That was how capitalism found an outlet for all of this surplus that was there, all of these profits. But obviously that in itself was only a temporary solution, only creates a temporary kind of equilibrium in the economy, if you like. But it's a temporary equilibrium at the same time creates even bigger contradictions for the future. Because now you're building up more productive forces that are producing more commodities that need to find more of a market. But at the same time, the market's shriveling away as wages are driven down and so forth. And and that's kind of what you see really is the contradiction behind Keynesian policies. The idea of government stimulus is basically this idea. Keynes never really understood, Keynes was trying to write in the 1930s at a time where you had the Great Depression. He was trying to explain why you had such mass unemployment, why the economies in the world found themselves mired in this kind of this crisis. And he pointed out, there was a vicious circle, basically, where because of the inability of workers to absorb all the goods, you had capitalism would stop producing. But if capitalists stop producing, then that means making more people unemployed. But if they made more people unemployed, there'd be even less of a market. And in other words, he was saying, that capitalism in crisis was stuck in this vicious circle that would constantly drag it further and further down. And what Keynes said was that it was a problem of what he called underconsumption. In other words, if only you could make up for the lack of the demand in the economy, then you could reverse this vicious circle and actually push capitalism out of crisis. And so he proposed that it was government spending ultimately that had to be used to actually get out of these kind of vicious circles and stimulate the economy, make up for that lack of demand, and turn a vicious circle into a virtuous one. But obviously the real question that Keynes never really asked was, well, where does the government get that money from in the first place? The government doesn't have any money of its own, and ultimately it has to raise money through taxes, either through taxing the working class, which actually has the contradictory effect of of reducing their spending power, or they have to tax the capitalists, which would drive down their profits and reduce their investment in the economy, and would bring therefore a strike of capital, and you'd get actually make the crisis even worse. So, and that's really what you see the limits of Keynesianism. But you also see, as I say, the fact that all of that investment, all of that Keynesian investment, if it's going to be going into anything useful, and often it wasn't. Often you see that, you know, in New Deals type programs, or in these massive Keynesian programs you've seen in China today, it's a case of building bridges to nowhere, or houses, giant cities that lie empty. In other words, it's malinvestment that doesn't go into actually increasing real wealth in society. It's similar, and in fact, the army and military spending plays a similar role. It's like, you know, spending enormous amounts that don't go into exchange, that don't go into the real economy, but are just lying idle and wasted. And that's what you see today. And where it is invested into real production, this kind of Keynesian spending, all it does is actually create even bigger problems in the future. Like in China, it creates even bigger excess capacity and creates bigger instability on a world scale. And this was the problem that obviously capitalism faced in general, that all this reinvestment in the economy to create new forces of production, eventually it meant actually saturating the world market. You find by the First World War that all the big imperial powers, through trying to find new sources of profit, through investing into in new machinery and new technology, creating bigger forces of production, eventually they come up against each other as you find the world market becomes saturated. And that's really the basis for the First World War. It's an imperialist war where all the different imperialist powers suddenly come up against each other, and the new rising imperialist powers, like Germany, for example, find themselves, if they want to expand their market, having to encroach on the markets of others. And that was really the cause behind First World War, which in turn acted to destroy much of the productive forces. And it laid the basis for a brief reemergence of growth in the 20s, although mainly in America. In Britain, actually, you had the continuation of the crisis as British capitalism, which had been so dominant, suddenly found itself playing second fiddle to American capitalism. And you see actually the beginning of British capitalism's decline starts in the First World War, and Britain becomes a second-rate imperialist power from then on. You see a continued crisis through the 20s. In America, you have a brief boom, the Roaring 20s, based on a lot of stock market speculation and so forth. And all of that obviously came crashing down it was a temporary phenomena. It came crashing down with the Great Depression of 1929, and that's when, as I say, you see the emergence of Keynesianism as an attempt to try and get out of the crisis. But really, it didn't work at all. You had 10 years of continued crisis with some ebbs and flows in the economy. But ultimately, it was only the Second World War that mopped up all the unemployed, with the state taking control of large sections of the economy and actually investing in new technologies, new machinery, and so forth. And above all, the destruction of the Second World War. You know, Germany, Japan, large sections of Europe, all of these leveled. And that kind of destruction of the productive forces, along with the emergence of America as a dominant global player, as the dominant imperialist power, the hegemon, if you like, after 1945, able to break open the world market. The dollar basically becomes the international currency, as good as gold, with all of the gold in Fort Knox backing it up, and the Bretton Woods system of currency and world world exchange backing up the whole monetary system. All of these factors, along with the huge levels of expenditure into new machinery and productivity and from the state during the Second World War, all of these different factors combine to give capitalism a new lease of life in the post-war period. It was that post-war boom and those factors combining together that meant you had this brief renaissance of capitalism, where for 25 years you had continued economic growth. And really that was the basis then for kind of the reformist policies we see of the day, the creation of welfare states, of the NHS here in Britain, of course. You know, all of that was the product of this post-war boom. But within that whole period, you've got obviously increasing investment going on, particularly this Keynesian spending going on, this demand side management. Keynesianism became kind of the dominant paradigm in economics at the time, and the economists thought that they could just control the whole economy through these levers. But obviously, even that boom, whilst lasting for 25 years, could not last forever. And there were people who did think it was it could last forever. You had even people on the left, so-called Marxists, capitulating to Keynesianism, thinking that capitalism had somehow overcome all its contradictions, that you could just have permanent expenditure on military to keep the economy going, not understanding that actually that far from stimulating the economy, that was a massive drain on the economy. And in fact, it's because of the huge Keynesian expenditure in arms, military, particularly in America with the Vietnam War and other wars in that period, that actually becomes an enormous drain on the economy. It actually sucks the life out of capitalism, leads to massive inflation spreading across the world through the Bretton Woods system, which eventually collapsed at the beginning of the 70s. And eventually you see the oil crisis in the 70s being, if you like, the final straw that breaks the camel's back and tips the world back into world crisis. And what follows is the attempts by the capitalists to restore profitability to the system, to try and attack the working class to get out of the crisis. And you see obviously that represented politically through Thatcherism and Reaganism, and driving down the wages, taking on the trade unions. And capitalism then gets a new lease of life, particularly then with the reintroduction of capitalism in China, the fall of the Soviet Union beginning in 1989 with the fall of the Berlin Wall. And suddenly the world markets opened up again to capitalism. All these new markets opened up in China with new sources of cheap labour providing the basis for capitalism to keep on growing. But nevertheless, throughout that period, that contradiction is re-emerging, that contradiction of overproduction. Because you've got the driving down of wages, Thatcher and Reagan, the ruling class worldwide taking on the working class, driving down the wages. But again, the question has to come about of, well, who's going to buy all the goods that capitalism is producing? And you see, therefore, capitalism taking on a new lease of life through the expansion of credit, which has always existed, the idea of credit. Marx had explained, actually, even in the 19th century, what the role of credit was, in the sense of, he said it was the means by which capitalism temporarily overcome the contradiction of overproduction by artificially expanding the market in the short term. That was the role of credit. Not on the one hand, it also kind of lubricated the whole system, allowed the capitalists to keep investing and reinvesting without having to save up loads of money in the meantime. The whole banking system played that role. But on this larger scale, it plays the role also of basically temporarily artificially expanding the market. And you see this role of credit really taking off in the 80s. Financialization, the Big Bang here in London of deregulation of the financial system, all these new ways of packaging up debt and expanding credit, mortgages, loans, credit cards, all of this taking off, an unprecedented expansion of credit. And this was really, as I say, a temporary way of overcoming the crisis, but only, as Marx always pointed out, only by paving the way for even bigger crises in the future. And it's worth actually just tangentially looking at the economist Hayek at this point, who's a very right-wing economist, very neoliberal economist, who's often cited as being one of the leading economists who explained crisis. And Hayek said that crisis was because of this deregulation, because of basically actually the There was too much encouragement, in fact, by the government in setting interest rates low. They artificially expanded these credit bubbles, allowed bubbles to form. And he said that was the basis behind crisis. Was allowing these bubbles to form, encouraging these bubbles to form. And he said, if only you never did that. If only the government didn't interfere, actually, by setting interest rates artificially low and so forth, encouraging credit to expand, then you wouldn't ever get these crises. You would the economy would work itself out. The invisible hand would keep everything under control. Now, what Hayek never really pointed out was, well, what would happen actually if the capitalists hadn't introduced measures to expand credit in the 80s? The point is that if you hadn't had the expansion of credit in the 80s, it's not like the economy would have just kind of settled into a nice equilibrium. No, what would have happened was basically the crisis we're going through today would have been brought forwards much earlier. The crisis that had hit in the 70s would never have been overcome, and in fact the economy would have gone into a downward spiral much quicker. In other words, it's not the expansion of credit that causes the crisis, but rather it's merely a method by which the capitalists delay the crisis. And the real contradiction is that of overproduction, the fact that capitalism produces far more than the market can absorb. That's the role of credit that Hayek never really explained. And obviously this all exploded eventually in 2007, 2008, the default on the subprime mortgages spreading through the financial system, and you get the credit crunch, which again is, it's not the lack of credit caused the crisis, but Marx said it was the crisis that caused the lack of credit. The fact that you have this enormous overproduction in the system, and this becomes realized as people start defaulting on things like mortgages, and then the banks, which normally lend to each other, start worrying about where all their debts are, and suddenly they stop lending to each other, and that you have the bailing out of the banks in order to keep the whole system going. And in doing so, what starts as a financial, what seems to start as a financial crisis, develops into a complete economic crisis. That's the point. It's not the crisis is not simply one of the banking system and of the financial system. That is merely a symptom of this deep underlying crisis of capitalism, this crisis of overproduction that exists everywhere on a world scale. And that's why we're seeing what we see today, which is this seemingly intractable crisis where they can't get out of it. And we would call it today really an organic crisis of capitalism, where all the contradictions are now coming to the fore. It's not just one of these kind of temporary boom and slumps that capitalism occasionally goes through. But there is that kind of more frequent, like breathing almost, of the capitalist system, where it, you know, occasionally purges itself of individual sectors that might have excess capacity or so forth. But no, this isn't like that faster rhythm of capitalism that it goes through. This is something much deeper. All the different contradictions that have been building up for decades now coming to the fore. And it's for that reason that you find that the capitalists find there's no real way out for themselves, that there's no weapons in the arsenal left for them in terms of, you know, Keynesian measures impossible at a time really when government debts are sky high and the market is telling governments it has to cut interest rates that they would normally lower to stimulate the investment are already rock bottom. And that's why you see increasingly desperate measures being taken by the capitalists. The idea of quantitative easing, for example, which I don't have time to go into fully explain here, but the point is it's not a sign of strength of capitalism that it has this quantitative easing at its disposal. It's a sign of weakness, actually. It's a desperate measure that, far from actually solving the problems of the economy, is actually increasing the instability on a world scale. All this money getting into the economy, inflating asset prices across the world and so forth, creating greater instability, not greater stability. And so you find this situation where really both sides of the capitalist class, in terms of the Keynesians and the neoliberals, they're both arguing against each other, but they're both right and they're both wrong. And that in itself is a reflection of the impasse capitalism finds itself in, where the Keynesians are right on the one hand to say, well, look, austerity is cutting away at the market, and the more austerity you have, the deeper the recession becomes. You see that very clearly, obviously, in a place like Greece today. But on the other hand, you know, the neoliberals are right as well, saying, look, we need to cut because there's these huge debts and they're weighing down on the economy, and they're demanding, therefore, austerity. And the point is, therefore, that austerity is not ideological. It's not a question simply of the nasty capitalists. It's a reflection of there is no other way out for capitalism at this time. And the fact that they've now used up all these reserves, all the weapons in their arsenal, that makes this prospect of a new world slump even scarier for the capitalists. Because, as I say, now it's not just in Europe and Britain and America, but now China's being brought in, all the other emerging economies, the Eurozone continuing to be in crisis. And therefore, the situation is even worse now than in 2007, 2008, because they've used up basically all these methods already, and there's no tools left for when this new world slump kicks in. And what makes it even worse from the capitalist point of view, from the ruling class's point of view, is obviously that it's not just an economic situation that's changed in the last 7 years, but the political and social situation has been transformed as well. The whole of consciousness has been changed on a world scale in the last 7 years. You've had all these political earthquakes in Greece, in Spain, in Scotland, and the rest of Britain now with the Corbyn movement, in the US with Bernie Sanders and Occupy. Everywhere we look, we see that obviously consciousness has changed massively since the crisis hit in 2008. And that obviously makes the prospect of a next world slump even scarier for the ruling class, because now you have a working class, you know, the 99% that are far more organized, that are far more radicalized, and are looking for an alternative. And the alternative, as far as we're concerned as Marxists, is obviously sitting right under our nose. We can see it in the form of the huge quantities of wealth that I said are sitting there idly, unable to be invested by the capitalists because of this huge overproduction on a world scale. We can see the technologies that are potentially there. I was just reading the other day Paul Mason's new book, Post-Capitalism, where he talks about how information technology, digital media, all these things have shown the enormous contradictions that capitalism's facing, where we've got the potential to supply culture in infinite quantities, in the sense of once you've produced an MP3 or a video or whatever, it's infinitely replicable at no extra cost. Its price should be zero according to the market. And yet, obviously, these monopolies like Apple, like Facebook, like Google, they have to have a monopoly just to keep the prices high, just to be able to keep making profits out of these kind of digital economies. We see that, in other words, a potential there with all that technology, not only on the one hand automation, as I talked about earlier, but the potential to have this superabundance of so many things. And it's not just digital commodities, but obviously food and medicines, all these things that are held back by currently by the question of private ownership and production for profit. And the control of this wealth and of this technology in the hands of the 1%. In other words, private ownership has become this enormous barrier to the development of society. It's become an enormous fetter. And therefore, the solution for us is an easy and an obvious one. The need to get rid of this private ownership, not of the small businesses and the you know, personal property that people have, but the main levers of the economy, the commanding heights, as Marx called them. Bringing these, the banks and the major monopolies that dominate every sector of the global economy, bringing these into public ownership, in nationalization, under workers' control, getting rid of the anarchy of the market, and utilizing this planning that already exists, actually, in within these giant monopolies. Every giant monopoly has planning, if you like, internally, producing according to a plan in order to decrease costs and increase efficiency and increase profits. Point is, we want to take that same plan that exists within companies, but now get rid of the competition, the anarchy between these major monopolies, and have a plan across the whole of the economy, a democratic, rational plan. That's what socialism and the transformation, socialist transformation of society is about. It's about, you know, getting rid of one set of laws, the capitalist set of laws, and replacing them with a new set of laws, an economy that operates according to a new paradigm, if you like, and that has to be a socialist plan of production in Britain and internationally. Anyway, that's the Marxist analysis. That's what Marx had to say about crisis, about capitalism. And importantly, he pointed, therefore, to the way forward. And that's what we're fighting for today. I'll leave it there. Okay, well, it was a very good discussion. And thank you for all the contributions and questions. To just come back on some of the points. The housing question, which several contributions have referred to. Really, what you're seeing now, as several people have pointed out, is really how housing has more and more become the kind of victim of speculation, if you like. That itself is a reflection of the crisis of overproduction, where all of these kind of things that should play some sort of useful role, you know, whether it's certain raw materials, you know, you've got speculation in food, there's speculation in art and wines and, you know, very cultural things, you know. And then housing is such an extreme part of this, where basically, obviously, you've got properties being bought up, not at all ever with the intention of actually living in them, but purely as investment vehicles, purely people trying to make money out of money and getting on the property bubble that's taking place, particularly in somewhere like London. And obviously the result is these extraordinary contradictions where you have, as people have pointed out, homelessness alongside empty mansions. And in fact, it highlights the political crisis as well, or the social crisis, in the sense that here you've got a situation where people are trying to overcome this dichotomy, if you like, by occupying the homes. You have squatters and so forth, but you see them evicted, and it shows how the law, I'm sure this is being discussed in the other session on the state, the law ultimately is a question of the law of maintaining property rights, and it's above all about those property rights, because here you see with housing so clearly how the right of those people who've bought that house as an investment vehicle trumps the right of those people to have a home. The squatters are evicted because it threatens the use of that property as an investment vehicle for the rich. What else? Jonas asked an interesting question about quantitative easing, how you'd expect all this money that's being printed. I mean, first of all, what is quantitative easing? Well, it's not quite as simple as printing money, because if that was the case, then you'd expect some sort of situation like, you know, Weimar Germany, where it's just hyperinflation, as Jonas pointed out. Obviously, that's not happening, and part of the reason is the way in which quantitative easing works, which is whereby the central bank basically creates money in order to buy up assets from the other banks, and in doing so tries to free up basically money that the bank has to then lend and make riskier loans, if you like, to business and to houses, with the idea that'll then cause them to consume and invest and hopefully stimulate the economy. But the fact is, as I think Scott pointed out, most of these banks aren't then lending this money on. You're not seeing an increase in investment. You're not seeing an increase in demand in the economy. But in fact, the banks are just using this money to kind of shore up their bank balances. And some of this money is obviously finding its way into the wider economy. And in doing so, inflating asset prices, it's creating instability. It's acting also as a kind of way for different currencies to try and competitively devalue to a certain degree as well. You're getting it's become a form of protectionism almost, which again shows you how it adds to the instability on the world scale. But I think the important point is also that when we talk about money and the relationship between the money supply and inflation, we've got to understand that kind of law, if you like all laws that we talk about in the economy, is only really a tendency. And obviously there can always be countervailing tendencies. And the countervailing tendency you're seeing at the moment is the fact that although the money supply is being increased through these kind of methods, whether it's credit or quantitative easing or whatever, you know, in Japan they've effectively doubled the money supply through quantitative easing. In Britain, obviously, we've printed £375 billion worth in quantitative easing. Which is something like 20% of GDP. But the countervailing side to this is the enormous downward pressure on prices because of the lack of demand in the world economy, the huge excess capacity. In other words, overproduction is pushing prices down. It's pulling the whole economy downwards, and therefore. As has been said, it's that the fact that quantitative easing even doesn't have an effect. It shows it's like the drug has already been used up. The body has already become immune to the drug. It's that they've used tried so hard to constantly get that next kick into the economy that each extra addition is diminished returns, if you like. And you see this with the question of credit itself, where I think in the Chinese economy, for example, it used to be that every $1 worth of debt would create $1 worth of investment, and now it's something like $4 are needed to create $1 of investment. So in other words, you're getting these diminished returns more and more. The economy is so sick, so full of all these contradictions that the measures become more and more useless and futile that the capitalists have to try and get out of these crises. Rosa talked about the so-called German economic miracle and its basis in the exploitation of the German workers. And obviously, alongside this, you've also had the massive investment of machinery and in productivity in Germany. But obviously, that has created this huge overproduction within the German economy. And the solution to that for the German capitalists was the Eurozone, basically. Was the creation of a market, a free market, where they could basically lend this huge excess, this huge surplus that the German economy is producing, lend it through German banks to European banks through to the peripheral economies to buy back German goods. And obviously you see, therefore, as Rosa pointed out, how Germany is very much interlinked to these countries around it, and the Euro crisis has really exposed all these contradictions where whatever they do is kind of wrong from the point of view of capitalism. On the one hand, they don't want Greece to leave the Eurozone because they know it could unravel the whole Eurozone that is the basis for the German economy's boom, basically. But on the other hand, they can't, keep pouring money into a bottomless pit, which is what Greece and other countries have become. They can't keep funding consumption in these other places. So you end up with a situation where whatever they do is wrong, because the point is, it's not a crisis of the Eurozone, it's a crisis of capitalism. And it's just expressing itself in different ways in different countries. The Eurozone creates a particularly acute crisis because you have all the different countries locked together. And obviously, as long as they're all going in the same general direction, there's generally boom, then everything can be kept together. But as soon as you've got a crisis, then obviously all the economies are moving in different directions, but they're all tied together, and it creates all those national tensions coming to the fore. We'll talk about it in this afternoon session on Europe, but you see, really, on a capitalist basis, Europe is falling to pieces, frankly, and there's no way out for the European capitalists, whether it's inside the Eurozone or outside. But with Germany as well, obviously it's linked to China. There's an enormous amount of export of capital goods that Germany produces to places like China. And again, the Chinese slowdown having an effect on Germany there. So again, all of these things are interlinked, and really it's a question of when, not if, in terms of these stronger economies being brought into the crisis also. Yes, Scott talked about this idea of creative destruction, and other people have alluded to it as well in terms of the coal and the steel industries. This is always the mantra of the capitalists, is a phrase termed by a capitalist economist called Schumpeter, actually. And basically is the idea that, you know, capitalism would bring about progress, would bring about technological revolutions and so forth through what he called creative destruction. Otherwise, the old industries were destroyed, the uncompetitive ones that couldn't keep up. But in doing so, that would free up the capital, free up the human resources and the money to then be poured into other new kind of innovative sections of the economy. And obviously, there is some historical basis to this idea. It's not, you know, all the bourgeois ideas in terms of economics, and in fact, in all of society, they always have some material historical basis. You know, obviously, otherwise they wouldn't be able to exist at all. They wouldn't be taken at all seriously. They have to have some sort of grain of truth to them. And obviously, historically, there is a grain of truth to the idea of creative destruction. That, you know, once upon a time, the vast majority of the population was involved in agriculture, but as innovation came about, people were, you know, as you had increased productivity on the land, more of those people could be taken from the land and into new innovative sections in industry, and vice versa. With automation, you get people moving from industry into services. The real thing now, though, that is really worrying even the bourgeois economists, is that this creative destruction is going to be very much destruction and not much creation, in the sense that now you've freed up labor from agriculture and from industry. It's all, you know, service-based economies in places like Britain. We don't make anything anymore, and there's already excess capacity of kind of manufactured goods and so forth on a world scale. So it's all in services. And the point is now they're talking about, well, even the services sector is going to be absolutely kind of turned upside down by automation. There was a study by some Oxford economists where they predicted 47% of jobs in the US could be automated away and made redundant by 2030. And they were saying the real sectors of the economy that were going to be hit hardest by this were not the manufacturing and so forth, which has already seen this process taking place, but white-collar jobs. People, even like doctors, who could be replaced by, you know, you can get health apps on your iPhone now and diagnose you, apparently. You got lawyers and accountancy, translation, for example, all these kind of things that used to require human skill and obviously highly educated workers. Now all of these people are being thrown onto the scrap heap, or will be thrown onto the scrap heap as well, and there isn't any kind of obvious sign of where these people are going to go, of where the next of where the next wave of innovation is that's going to employ all these people, because, you know, technology isn't some sort of deus ex that just, it's not a manna from heaven that just kind of falls from the sky and suddenly, you know, you create jobs out of nowhere. You have to have a material basis for innovation and for the deployment of technology. You know, the famous example we often use is how even in, I think it was ancient Greek times, in Alexandria, someone invented the steam engine. The idea of a steam engine has existed for thousands of years. But the reason it didn't get fully deployed to increase productivity across society until the Industrial Revolution was because in the slave society, it played no role. There was no need to increase productivity. It was you had slaves, and the way you increased wealth was by getting more slaves through war and conquest. And it was only with capitalism, as I said earlier, with the idea of wage labor, where you were buying the ability of the worker to work, buying the labor power, that there was an incentive to invest, to have new technologies like steam that could rapidly increase productivity. And today we find the same sort of thing. There's enormous potential, if you like, for technology. We can see, you know, 3D printing, all these digital technologies I talked about earlier. You know, you can see the potential to use these to increase leisure time, to automate vast sections of society, and in fact it would make the idea of planning economy very simple. But obviously it can't be used within the material limits of capitalism, within the barrier of private ownership and production for profit. And even science itself and the whole process of innovation is ultimately limited by what capitalism and what the material basis in society can provide. If you've got a situation where you've got artificial scarcity in society, and competition over the limited resources that are kind of falling off the table of the capitalists for the rest of society, then that in itself, you know, that creeps into every facet of society. In other words, you know, the logic of competition asserts itself even in the public sector, even in scientific research, in universities. You have limited resources because of austerity, and so academics now, even though they're all within the same public sphere and public funding, they're ultimately forced to compete against each other to produce papers just for the sake of it in order to gain access to funding. And the result is that you're getting this huge degradation to science itself. And The Economist ran an article the other year where they said that something like, you know, 50% of scientific papers aren't validated and could just be bunk, they said. You know, in other words, it's just nonsense science being produced just for the sake of it in order for academics to get, you know, a quantity of papers out rather than quality. In other words, the very quality of the scientific research we do is being undermined because of competition, because of the lack of resources that capitalism provides, and therefore, you know, there's no obvious way in which you're seeing how science is going to be taken forwards, how technology is going to be taken forwards, how society is going to be taken forwards. Capitalism, as I said, is become unable to develop the forces of production. And it was that Marx ultimately said was the real test of whether a system was progressive or not. And when it could no longer take forward the forces of production, develop science and technology and culture and so forth, at that point, Marx said, you would get these crises. It would become obvious that a revolution was needed to let the productive forces, to let standards of living carry on expanding. And you know, in terms of this back to this creative destruction, again, we see obviously with coal mining in the 80s in Britain, now the steel industry. See, obviously, that capitalism, you know, if it's left up to the anarchy of the market, if it's left up to the invisible hand, obviously it has to go through this kind of chaotic process in order to reallocate jobs from one sector to another. You know, we would say, obviously, in the long run, something like coal could not survive as an industry, because obviously we would be wanting green technologies, environmentally friendly ways of producing energy. But obviously capitalism can't reallocate resources in society in that kind of way, in a rational way, from one sector to another. It can only do it in that anarchic way, in that destructive way, where a whole generation is thrown onto the scrap heap. And obviously that's why we call really for a socialist plan of production. If it's only by taking control of the banks of these major industries that you can retrain workers through a lifelong process to be able to move from one sector to another, where you can allocate the resources, take them out of one sector and place them in the green energy, for example, that we need, and do it in a rational way that means people aren't left on the left to the dogs of competition. Steve and others talked about inequality, and obviously the incredible inequality we see today with the 1% owning something like 50% of the world's wealth. And obviously you've seen people like Piketty who've come forward and tried to explain this. Thomas Piketty became very popular with his book also called Capital, although I think, like with superhero movies, the original's always better. So don't get the reboot. I don't think anyone who actually reviewed the book could have read it, because if they'd read it, their reviews would have been very different. Because although he talks about, he provides very good statistics on how inequality has changed over time and how it's reached such incredibly intense levels today, He doesn't really ever explain the cause of inequality. It's very much a historical description of its development, but never actually looking at the laws within capitalism that give rise to inequality. And that obviously means that he can't ever explain the solution, really. The solution, according to Piketty and all these kind of reformists, is, you know, the idea of just tax the rich, basically. A policy that's failed to work in Piketty's own country, in with Francis Hollande, who tried to tax the rich, was found that he couldn't because the rich had a strike of capital, and then and the result was he's actually now carrying out worse austerity than his predecessors, and it's the same obviously in Greece today. And what Piketty, as I say, never really explains is how inequality is not some sort of byproduct of, it's not like a nasty kind of tumor on the side of capitalism that you can just cut away. You know, this is really the idea of all reformists, is that you can cut the nasty bits of capitalism away and create some sort of good capitalism, get rid of the nasty finance and make nice manufacturing, as though finance wasn't always an inherent part of the capitalist system. And the point is, inequality itself is not something that you can just a nasty symptom that you can cure. It's an inherent part of the capitalist system. The fact is, capitalism is inequality in the sense that, where does profit come from? What is the basis for the capitalist system? It is the production of profit, a production for profit, and that profit is the unpaid labour of the working class. In other words, the wealth that accumulates for the few is very much necessitated upon the exploitation of the many. You can't not have inequality within capitalism. To get rid of inequality would be to get rid of capitalism. And that is something that Piketty never points out, and that all of these reformists never really point out. And that, I think, is why, just to sum up, we have to discuss the questions of Marxist economics. We have to discuss the question of crisis of capitalism, is to understand the real laws that are at play in society, and you know, look and understand these general lessons, not just for academic interest, as people have pointed out from the contributions, but because to understand you know, why capitalism goes into crisis and why it will go into crisis and continue to go into crisis. And this really is the one of the last questions that was asked was, you know, when can we expect the next crisis? Well, I think we're still going through the beginning. It's not like you can say the last crisis ever really ended. That's the point. It's a continuation. The whole of the last 7 years, it'll be ebbs and flows in the situation. But obviously we can talk about a next slump, which I think is very much around the corner. But it's all part of the same ongoing crisis of capitalism. We never really got out of the last one. And obviously that the fact that there is a new world slump on the horizon has enormous impacts on consciousness. And that's what we need to understand, that you know, the material basis for reformism has been withered away. The post-war boom is not going to come back. You know, there were particular circumstances that allowed that to happen that don't exist anymore. It's much, the crisis is much deeper now. There's no recovery on the horizon, let alone talk of a boom. And therefore, any party that comes into power on a reformist program is going to instantly find itself faced with that deep world slump and faced with the prospect of having to make deep cuts and deep austerity. We see that in Greece. Where within the space of 6 months, a party elected on a radical left program ends up carrying out worse austerity than its predecessors. That shows the inability of reformism in this intense period of crisis to offer a way out. And that's the kind of prospect that's going to face a Corbyn government. From, you know, before he's even in power, they're already attacking him. And obviously, once he's in power, there'll be strikes of capital if he tries to take on the rich, if he tries to tax them. You'll have strikes of investment. The capitalists will use every tool in the box to basically force him to retreat on the question of anti-austerity politics. And that means that we have to be prepared ourselves to argue for a genuine alternative, to actually say, look, there is no reformist way out of this crisis. There is not a crisis of austerity or ideas. It's not an ideological question that you can just get rid of the nasty Tories. It's a result of the actual system itself, of the deep contradictions within the system on a world scale, We need to understand those laws, why capitalism is going into crisis, understand that there is no way out within capitalism, and therefore give the only alternative that there is, which is a revolutionary transformation where we understand these laws not just to reform them, but to fundamentally transform them, to change the whole way in which society operates so that we can get rid of these crises, get rid of this austerity. And as I say, the only solution, therefore, is a socialist one. And that's obviously what we need to discuss here and have that conviction to be able to argue for in the labour movement. Argue that.